Hello everyone, my name is GP Vahan. I'm a fantasy artist and a storyteller. I'm also the creator of Mythology and Beyond. So what is a mythology? It's a collection of stories pertaining to a culture and their tradition. That's the easiest way that I can explain it. So myths are very important to us. We still live it. Even though people think mythology is something in the past, it's not so. We still use mythology in our everyday lives. It's in our language. And how else will you understand another culture? You understand them through their stories, through their myths. Learning the myths of a particular culture makes you understand how they lived at the time, or makes you understand their traditions, their religion, their food. How was their world like at that time, and where are they now? That's what mythology does, is it introduces you to that culture. And what you get to realize is when you study a lot of mythology, world mythology in particular, you get to understand that all these myths are telling the same story. And what that story is, it's the human story. It's the story of the world. I'll give you an example. We use mythology in our everyday lives. Every culture has mythology in their language, even though they might not know it. As an example, days of the week in English. You know, we have Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. That's also Wotan's Day. Wednesday is Wotan's Day. Wotan, or Odin, is the Norse god, the father of the gods in Norse mythology, the old one-eye. That's Odin, Wotan, Wednesday. We also have Thursday, which is Thor's day. Thor, the god of thunder, who is also the son of Odin. And then we have Friday, which is Freya's day. And Freya is the wife of Odin. So you see something that's in Norse mythology, the gods and the goddess of Norse mythology, we use it in our English language as an everyday thing. Another example I can give you is Egyptian mythology. For example, Horus, the bird god of Egyptian mythology. Horizon. Horus has risen. See, it goes back to Horus, Egyptian mythology. Or hours of the day. You know, 24 hours of the day, 12 hours of the day. Horus took 12 steps over the sun until the sun set. Now, who is the uncle of Horus? The uncle of Horus is Set, the god of darkness. Sun set, darkness set. So you see, Egyptian mythology somehow got into English. And that's how it is with world mythology. And it's not just in the language either. It's also in its symbols and symbolism. For example, this symbol right here, which is also the same symbol right there. This symbol. This is the symbol of the sun. It's an Armenian symbol, which dates back to 10,000 years, I would say. And it's called the Wheel of Eternity. And what this represented was the sun. So the ancient Armenians at the time, they were sun worshippers. Why the sun? I mean, it's pretty obvious. You know, the sun gives you warmth, it gives you light, it helps things grow. So the sun was worshipped, and that was their symbol, the symbol of the sun called the Wheel of Eternity. Now, it also represents time, actually. The wheels, it's turning like that, that represents time. Time is passing by. What else does this remind you of? Something more modern. It's a pinwheel, right? The toy, the pinwheel. An Armenian toy maker back in 1919, right here in Massachusetts, invented the pinwheel. And he based it off of this symbol, which is the symbol of the sun. So you see, once again, different cultures mixing and taking their stories, intermixing, and that's what mythology does. Mythology is not bound to one culture. It's to the world. Every culture has a mythology, but what you find out is all these myths, again, are telling the same story, which is the story of the world. It's Earth's story. There was this Greek philosopher called Diogenes. So they asked Diogenes, this Greek philosopher, where he comes from. And his reply was, I am not an Athenian, I am not Greek, I am a citizen of the world. That says it all pretty much, you know, and that's what mythology is. As humans, we're not meant to be in borders. So that's what mythology does. It breaks down borders. After all, we're on this sphere. We're all on it. And the sphere is floating in space in blackness. I mean, that's as mythical as it gets. So we're already living a mythology right here. So when it comes to mythology, we learn about, you know, love, hate, gods, goddesses, creation, destruction, and the center of it is human. So our mythology teaches us about ourselves, which reminds me of a parable, an Armenian parable, about the eagle and the arrow.
An eagle was soaring high in the sky when an arrow struck him in the breast. As he fell, he looked at the arrow, feathered with eagle plumes. "Woe is me," he cried. "I am the cause of my own destruction."
So you might have heard that story in your own culture, in your own version. But that's what myths do. They teach us about ourselves. And that's what I want to do in this very program. I want to show you that there's all these myths out there about different cultures, cultures that have never met each other, but somehow they're telling the same story. And again, that's the world's story. That's the human story. So before we get started on this journey, I want to talk a little bit about why I started Mythology and Beyond, because it's very important to me. So I've always loved mythology, world stories, learning about other cultures. It's just fantasy, being a fantasy artist. But the reason I started Mythology and Beyond, it kind of came out of a tragedy, unfortunately. I started it in 2020 when the world was well into COVID, but at the same time, there was atrocities happening on the other side of the world with towards Armenians. There was ethnic cleansing happening towards Armenians for the second time. A second genocide was happening in Artsakh, where now it's called Nagorno-Karabakh. So in 2020, hostile neighbor of Armenia decided to invade Artsakh and decided to do ethnic cleansing. And as a great-grandchild of genocide survivors, back in 1915, my great-grandparents actually survived the genocide caused by the Ottomans. So, and like all Armenians around the world, we started to panic that it's happening again, and yet again, nothing has learned from history. So, you know, we try to come up with ways of getting word out there or trying to be helpful, try to help our fellow Armenians. So I started thinking, what about our stories? I mean, Armenians actually go all the way back to 5,000 to 7,000 years. You know, Mesopotamia, Sumeria, Babylon. You know, we were there, they were there. So it's a pretty old culture. And there's all these stories that come with that culture and that region. So I start to panic. And I thought, what is going to happen to our stories? Is anybody going to remember the Armenians anymore? Because it's you know, it's still happening, unfortunately, the ethnic cleansing. It hasn't stopped. So at the time, I thought, let me tell these stories. Let me start a mythology channel. I will tell my culture's stories. And in turn, I will also tell other cultural stories. And in doing so, I will learn about other cultures. And I will also teach my culture to other cultures. And in that way, I get to show that, again, like I said, we are all telling the same story, which is a human story. So that's how Mythology and Beyond came about. In 2021 was the first episode of Akhtamar. So with these stories, you know, you get to learn about gods, goddesses, love, and loss.
Tamar was the name of an Armenian princess who lived on an island in Lake Van in historic Armenia, now modern-day Turkey. As the legend goes, Tamar was in love with a commoner from a village located in the mainland. Each night, the young man would swim from the mainland towards the lonely island to meet his love. Standing at the edge of the cliff by the lake, Tamar would shine a single light from her lantern, showing the way towards her. And each night they would meet in secret. As the story goes, one day her father found out about this union and was irate, as you can imagine. Her father followed her in secret to the edge of the cliff, where Tamar was waiting for her love, holding a lantern for him to see the way. Her father, in anger, grabbed the lantern from Tamar and smashed it on the rocks nearby, thus leaving the young man stranded in the middle of the lake with no direction as to where Tamar was and what direction to swim to. The young man swam for hours in the dark, calling her name, until he surrendered to exhaustion and drowned. People say his dying cries of Akhtamar, meaning O Tamar in Armenian, can still be heard on the darkest of nights, still to this very day. This is how the name of the island came to be. As to what happened to Princess Tamar, it is unknown, and we are left to wonder of her fate. Even though the Turkish government has occupied the region of Lake Van and Akhtamar Island, the Armenian people, in honor of this legend, have built a statue, placing it on the shores of Lake Sevan, Armenia, instead.
Love and loss are not unique to one particular culture. You find that story in many different cultures, such as the story of Romeo and Juliet, Tristan and Isolde, and many more. But Akhtamar is not really a mythology. It's more of a legend. So let's move on to mythology. And what I'm going to show you is two different videos of two different cultures that they've never met each other, none that I see in history. There's an interesting connection And that connection, again, is sorrow, but it's also hope.
According to Greek mythology, curiosity was given to us by Zeus, the father of the Olympians. To tell this story, we must go all the way back to the defeat of the Titans by the Olympians. Prometheus, brother of Epimetheus, who was one of the last of the Titans, stole fire from the gods and gave it to man. For this deed, he was punished by Zeus to suffer for all eternity. But this was not enough for Zeus. He feared that man had an equal ground with the gods by harnessing the power of fire. He wanted to punish man for accepting that gift. So according to the myth, he commanded the gods to create the first woman. Each one of them gave her a gift. Hephaestus created her from clay. Aphrodite gave her femininity. Athena taught her the craft of making. And Hermes gave her the name Pandora, and by the strict order of Zeus, gave her the gift of language and curiosity. Finally, Zeus handed her a heavy box covered in gold. He told her it was a gift to mankind, but under no circumstances she should open it. Zeus wanted Pandora to marry Prometheus, but Prometheus was unwilling to accept gifts from the gods because he could see the treachery behind it. Epimetheus, on the other hand, instantly fell in love with Pandora and accepted her as his wife. Pandora was happy with Epimetheus, but there was that box. And now regarding curiosity, it starts out as a small, tiny voice inside of you, calling you gently at first.
Pandora. Pandora.
Pandora.
Slowly breaking down your senses. The voice
Pandora.
From the box
Pandora.
Started getting louder
Pandora.
And louder
Pandora.
Where it could no longer be ignored. Pandora could no longer contain her insatiable curiosity and finally opened the box. Instantly, all manner of spectral and unearthly things flew out. She had unknowingly released war, famine, sickness, death, and all manner of evil into this world. She quickly closed the box, but it was too late. What have I done? She thought, feeling instant remorse. But it was not over yet. A small, tiny voice
Pandora.
Called out from the box.
Pandora.
This voice sounded different.
Pandora.
She opened the box once more. A tiny light shaped like a butterfly floated out, hovered there for a while, and suddenly spread its light into the world. Pandora instantly felt comforted. She came to realize that that light was hope. Zeus, being the architect behind all things, played his game well. Zeus wanted people to suffer in order to understand that they should not disobey the gods. But he also gave them hope to counter that suffering. Because he knows, without the people, the gods serve no purpose. Unfortunately, it was Pandora that was made to deliver that gift. She was not malicious, only curious. But after all, she was made that way. So can you really blame her? Something a little extra. Pandora's box was not actually a box. In the original story by the Greek poet Hesiod, he wrote down the word pithos in Greek,
which was essentially a large jar, a container, but was mistranslated as a box. Unfortunately, words, and with it some stories in history, are lost in translation.
Pandora's box is such an interesting mythology. It's an interesting tale of human suffering, why things happen. The Greeks explained it in that way. It's so much to dissect. I don't think we have enough time to do that. But just Prometheus alone, giving fire to the world. Fire represents so many things, fire is a double-edged sword. You can cook your food with it. It lights the way. It can also be used as a weapon, so it's a double-edged sword. So by giving fire to the world, he actually gave knowledge, which made, as you saw in the video, Zeus fear of man, because now man was on the same level as God. And for that, in the story, like I said, a woman was blamed, even though she was made to take the blame. So it's a very interesting tale that you can dissect on and on. So now we're going to leave Greek mythology, we're going to leave the Greek coast, and we're going to go to Africa.
The Rainbringer, the chief god in Zambia, the god of the sky in Angola, the high ruler in Zimbabwe. All of these were Liza and much more. He was the personification of nature. Thunder and rain followed him. He sometimes appeared in thick clouds and massive winds. And when people were a witness to this, it meant Liza was about to unleash his wrath. He was not all rage, destruction, and fear. Liza was also a creator and a teacher. As told in legend, Liza summons the honey bird to his domain in the sky. He hands over 3 calabashes to the bird, telling it to give it to the first men on earth as gifts. He tells the honey bird the 2 calabashes contain seeds for the men to cultivate the earth, but the 3rd calabash must not be opened until Liza himself comes down to give further instructions to the people. Upon receiving this information, the honey bird flew down to deliver the gifts. However, the honey bird was unable to contain its curiosity and opened the 3rd calabash. With this action, dangerous things were released upon the earth, such as poisonous snakes, wild beasts, disease, sickness, and death. Strangely enough, this story has eerie similarities to Pandora's box legend in Greek mythology. 2 different cultures, yet similar ways of introducing chaos through curiosity. Unlike Pandora's box, Liza wanted to teach the people about the 3rd calabash before opening it. But why introduce sorrow and death into the world to begin with, unless his intentions were to teach people how to live with those things? Like most myths and legends, this one also comes to an end. With the opening of the 3rd calabash and the release of its deadly contents into the world, Liza decided to teach mankind many crafts and skills in order to survive in this world.
After his work was done on this earth, he decided his time had come to leave. Liza ascended back to heaven on a spider's web, never to return. His people wanted to follow him to the beyond. So they too started to climb the web after him. But man was not meant to follow the gods. The spider web broke and they all fell back to the earth. According to legend, whenever a shooting star is seen in the heavens, that star is Liza, looking down and checking over the progress of his children.
So now you know the connection between Pandora's box, ancient Greek, and Liza, god of thunder in Africa. And it's just interesting how close and similar that story is. One was by opening the box and the other one with the calabash, fruit breaking and releasing all of that. But they both have hope at the end. Liza gives his people hope before he leaves at the end, and Pandora actually saves hope in the box. So even though it's somewhat of a tragedy, the story, there is hope at the end, which is beautiful. Now, what I also love about mythology is it's full of amazing, fantastical beasts. So for a fantasy artist, it's just the imagination can be just wherever I want to go with it, right? So one of those beasts that is rarely talked about is the Aralez, flying dogs in Armenian mythology.
There are many fantastic beasts in mythology and folklore. One of those creatures is the Aralez, found in Armenian mythology. The Aralez, or sometimes called Haralez, are dog-like creatures with immense wings. It is said that they live in the sky, or on Mount Ararat. They possess the power to heal fallen warriors and even resurrect the dead by licking their wounds away. The old Armenians believed that when a brave warrior fell in battle or was murdered by the hands of a traitor, these spirits called Aralez descended upon them and restored them to life by licking their wounds clean. Where does this idea come from? It is said that there is always a grain of truth in every myth. So, was there any truth in this story? As unlikely as it sounds, there is some scientific evidence that suggests dog saliva has some antibacterial properties. So let us think about this idea and how it came to be. Dogs instinctively lick wounds. Something in their body hurts, so naturally, they lick it. This idea that dogs lick wounds in order for them to heal is so engraved in ancient societies that it gave them the belief that dog saliva can also heal human wounds. Now, not to take anything away from the ancients, because this belief has some basis in fact, as I stated before, but over time has achieved mythic proportions. One such tale is the legend of Ara the Beautiful. Long story short, Ara, the king of old Armenia, fell in battle against the Assyrians. The queen of the Assyrians, who was infatuated with Ara, calls forth the Aralez to bring Ara back to life. I have commanded the gods to lick his wounds, and he shall live again. As to what happened, we will cover the story of Ara the Beautiful in a future episode. Getting back to the Aralez, it is said that they also appear in spirit form, which can mean that they can take different shapes and forms of dogs. I like to think that the reason one Aralez looks more different than the other is that it could be a personal thing. Let me explain. One fallen warrior might see a kinder and gentler creature, whereas another might see a more vicious, gruesome Aralez. The fallen could be projecting their inner fears of death to something frightening or something more inviting. Either way, the Aralez is an interesting concept passed down to us from the old storytellers. In closing, I will leave you with one final story. After the murder of Musher Mamigonian, who was a 4th century commander of the Armenian king's forces, it is written that his family could not believe in his death. Others expected him to rise, so they sewed the head upon the body, and they placed him upon a tower, saying, because he was a brave man, the Aralez will descend and raise him.
Well, now, if you're going to talk about dogs, you also have to talk about cats. And what better deity to talk about when it pertains to cats than Bastet, the cat goddess of Egyptian mythology.
Bastet, the Egyptian goddess of domesticity, fertility, women, and most of all, cats. She was known by many names, but the most prominent one is Bastet. The meaning of her name is unknown, or at least not universally agreed upon by scholars. Bastet was the daughter of the sun god Ra. She was known as the mother of all the pharaohs. Bastet was highly venerated because she protected the home from disease and evil spirits. She was also the primary protector of women and children. Because of Bastet's protection, women in ancient Egypt were held in high regard. Like many of the other Egyptian gods, she also played a role in the afterlife. She was a goddess of transformation and acted as a connection between the material and spiritual worlds. This was because of her close relations with Ra, or the Eye of Ra, the all-seeing eye. Cats in ancient Egypt were sacred to Bastet and her people. They were greatly prized because they protected Egypt's crops from unwanted vermin. Because of this, cats were treated almost like deities. Therefore, killing a cat was punishable by death. In closing, in the year 525 BC, Cambyses II of Persia invaded Egypt. Knowing that the Egyptians had great love towards their cats and Bastet, he had his soldiers paint the image of Bastet on their shields and march to the city of Pelusium. The Egyptian army, seeing the image of Bastet, refused to fight, fearing that they might offend the goddess. They therefore surrendered. To this day, cats still have a supernatural hold on many. So you can say that after 5,000 years, Bastet has not been forgotten.
So what the main thing you can take away from the Bastet video is how important cats were to the ancient Egyptians. As you saw, they took care of their vermin problem and disease. And they knew that about cats, so they kept them around, they deified them. So you see the connection there, why the love of cats. Plus, you know, being a cat owner myself, I can tell you cats do have this supernatural thing. When they look at you, their eyes, It's I can't explain it. Call me biased towards cats, but there's something really supernatural and amazing when you look at a cat's eyes. So there you have Bastet. Now we're gonna leave mythology a little bit and go back into ancient history. Now there are many reasons why I started Mythology and Beyond, like I said in the beginning, but one of the other reasons, one of the main reasons was mythology has a lot of strong male figures in it. Mythology and history has a lot of strong male figures in it, as well as strong female figures. But unfortunately, the female figures aren't rarely talked about. So that was one of the reasons why I wanted to do this video about a very particular special person called Aytsemnik, right here. She was an Armenian warrior general in ancient Armenia. Another reason why I wanted to do a video on Aytsemnik was if these stories are not told, then they are forgotten in history. And once they're forgotten, they're gone. You know, it would be like as if they never existed. And that's why I wanted to do a story about Aytsemnik. And Aytsemnik, the name, roughly translates to roe deer. So it's either Aytsemnik or Aytsemnik, which is roe deer. So let's watch the last video.
It is the year 1126 AD. The battle rages at the gates of the great city of Ani in Armenia. Through the fog of war stands one warrior among all the rest, an Armenian commander called Aytsemnik. Aytsemnik was an inspiring symbol of courage and heroism to her people, fighting to protect the city she loves again and again against constant invaders. During the reign of Ashot III in the Pakraduni dynasty, the city of Ani became the capital of Armenia, and as its wealth grew, so did the city. Sometime in the 11th century, it had reached its height in wealth and beauty in architecture, having built 1,001 churches in the city for people to worship. But what made the city of Ani special, besides its wealth and architecture, was its highly progressive society. In the city of Ani, women were equal to men. They held important positions such as merchants, bankers, architects, and warrior generals. Aytsemnik was one of many women that held high positions in the city. But all this wealth also made the city of Ani a target for aggressors to conquer. The battle continued on all throughout the night and into the day. Aytsemnik and the warriors of Ani had faced such aggression many times before and have overcome it. But eventually, all selflessness leads to death. As the superior numbered forces advanced, Aytsemnik fought to her last breath. And fell in battle. Her selflessness and the courage, along with the young Armenian women and men, won the city its freedom that day. But as time moves on, eventually the city fell. The once great city of Ani, which spanned 3 centuries and 5 empires, with the Pakraduni Armenians overtaken by the Byzantines, Seljuk Turks, Georgians, and eventually the Ottomans. Now, the city is in ruin, left there by its conquerors to fall into dust, decay, and to be forgotten. Even though the once great city and its people are gone, their memories of what they stood for are still with us. The selflessness of Aytsemnik and the women and men of that great city are remembered still to this very day.
Even though the Aytsemnik video is pretty short, nevertheless, the women of Ani are very inspiring, and her story is very inspiring, and that's the reason why I want to cover her story. Now, there are many more myths and legends on Mythology and Beyond, but I think for this episode, this is where we're going to stop it. But before we do that, I wanted to pull back the veil a little bit and show you how I make these videos, because I think it's very important for anyone that's out there that's very creative and you want to tell your story or you want to go into mythology or whatever it is, I think it's very important that I share how I make these videos. And that way you can go out and you can tell your stories or your cultural stories or other culture stories. So how do I make these videos? Now, let me tell you, it takes a long time. Each video, which is about 5 to 10 minutes, takes me about maybe 3 to 4 months to do. The reason for that is because I'm a one-man show. So how does the process work? How do I do this? First of all, what I do is I read a lot. I read a lot of myths, stories, legends, and I try to find stories and legends which is rarely talked about. That's why a lot of my mythology stuff that's on my channel are rarely talked about myths, such as the Aralez, the flying dog, which has never been covered, or even Aytsemnik, which has never been covered. So what I do is I try to find a particular story or a myth, and then I write a script according to that. Also, with the script, once I write this rough script, sometimes I give it to Sila Nazani from Palindrome Press, and she will go over the script, refine it, make it better, make it coherent, just so the thing will flow more. So sometimes she helps me out with that. Once the script is done, that's when I go into the art process of designing these characters. So I do storyboard illustrations, designing what I want to show according to the script. Little stories here and there, putting the whole thing together. Once the storyboard is done, I have an overall idea of what I want to show in the video, how this is going to be presented. Then I start going into character design and also landscape design, which is a long process in itself. So if it's a historical figure, let's say, or even a mythological figure, I do a lot of research. How are these mythological figures described? How do I see it in my head? So I'll make a few character designs, about 6 to 8 designs of a particular character of how they look, and then what is the landscape going to look like? But it has to resemble that culture, right? So once all those designs are done, the next process is to actually start doing the illustration work. And that can go from doing an acrylic painting to pen and ink to just black and white pencil drawing, anything, even Photoshop. Sometimes it's even live action. So I try to put live action in these videos just to make it more real. So that process takes a while to do. So every kind of media I can use to convey the story, tell the story in a better way, right? So the next step after the whole mixed media, all of that, is narration. Now I start reading the script, and that's multiple takes. You know, sometimes I want to hit this note high or hit this note low, emphasize this, or it's just different versions, different takes of how I'm telling the story. So that in itself could be multiple takes and multiple hours just to get it right. So once the narration is done, the next step is music. Now, music is very important to the story. Music is just like words, but in sound, obviously, if that makes sense. So in the past, what I've done is I've used a lot of music which has no copyright from YouTube, the YouTube library. So a lot of creative people have been out there and they've uploaded their music onto the YouTube library, and it's free for you to use as long as you credit them, which I've done in my videos. But try to find that exact music that fits your video. It's almost like a needle in a haystack, and you will never find that perfect music. And sometimes you have to use multiple different artist music, just like the one in Aytsemnik, just to pull the whole thing together. So that's a long process. It's multiple hours of going through free YouTube music, sound bites, whatever I can use, just so I can make the video better. So once that's done, then I find special sounds, like special effect sounds, like an army walking on gravel or whatever. And those I have to find and put together. So all of these that I do, it goes into just that file. Let's say the Akhtamar file, right? Everything goes into that Akhtamar file, the music, the paintings, the narration, everything is in there. Going back to music, actually, I've been very fortunate and lucky to find two amazing composers that are going to start working on my Mythology and Beyond videos going forward. One of them you actually hear in the background in this video. So for my last video called Eli from Norse Mythology, which I haven't shown you in this episode, but hopefully I'll show you in a further episode, perhaps. An amazing composer, Edgar, he actually reached out to me, and he decided to become the music for that episode, and that was beautiful. All I had to do was put the whole video together, send him the video, and he composed an all-new original music for that video. So I'm thankful for him for doing that for that episode, and hope to work with him further down the line. And going forward, Christopher is going to be doing my other videos on Mythology and Beyond, as well as, like I said, for this episode and various other projects that I have. So he is my composer who is constantly working with me and trying to create sounds and music, you know, going forward for Mythology and Beyond. So I'm very excited about that. So after the whole music is done, everything is put together, special effects, I have everything. This is where the fun starts for me. I love editing. You know, it's directing is great. You know, you shoot a lot of video, a lot of ideas, but it's the editing that pulls the whole thing together. So next step is to take all that stuff that I've accumulated and I put it in iMovie and I start editing it. You know, from the opening credits to the music to special effects such as fog going across or thunder or whatever, the narration, put the whole thing together. And then with the music, you try to smooth things out. That's when the real intense focus starts. You know, is it too slow? Is it too fast? Am I conveying what I'm trying to tell in the story? And I have to say, I've learned as I've gone along. You know, the first episode to where I am now, I've incorporated more techniques and more ways of doing these videos. So, but that's the best part, the editing for me, is pulling the whole thing together. So once the editing is done, everything is good to go. It's uploaded on YouTube, and it's for there for you to enjoy. So it is a long process. It takes a lot of work, a lot of time. You know, I put in my time. I don't get paid for that. It's out of pocket. But you know what? It's arts for me is like breathing air. You know, being creative is the most important thing for me, because that's when I know who I really am, when I'm being creative and I'm telling these stories and I'm getting this out from the heart. And ultimately, I'm a storyteller. That's what I try to do with these. So once these are out there, you know, whether if it's 2 months or 4 months or whatever, it's worth it at the end. And these stories are there, you know, they're there for others to experience and hopefully to be inspired. You know, if I can inspire one person to get out there and do their own videos on mythology, history, or whatever, just to share with the world, you know, and then my job is complete. And ultimately, that's why I do these videos, is just to educate people, to learn about other people's cultures, and that's what it is. Hopefully, once you learn about this other culture, you get to realize, hey, they're like me. You know, we're doing the same thing. We're saying the same thing. You know, all these goddesses, gods, different names, different faces, but same story. And ultimately, that's the human story, as I've said from the beginning. And with that, we have now come to the end of the story. So perhaps in another episode down the line in the future, I can come back and we can discuss more mythology and I can show you more videos and talk about it. So until then, I am GP Vahan and thank you for coming on this journey with me. Take care.